Lo, I can hear you.
What about now? Can you hear me? Can you hear me now? What about now? Can you hear me? Hello, Ahmed, can you hear me now? And now, can you hear me? All right. Well, it seems like we have a connection problem of some kind. So, can you hear me now?
Yeah, now I can hear you. Yeah.
Okay. Maybe there was a problem with the hangout. I also couldn't hear myself, but now it seems to be working. So, Ahmed, is this your first time in the class?
Yes, this is my first time. Yeah.
Okay, great. Where are you from, Ahmed?
I am from Egypt.
Okay, great. Are you in Egypt now?
Now, yes.
Okay. Fantastic. This class, we read short stories, we discuss them. It's a lot about pronunciation, but after we probably won't read the entire story in the class because we spend one class reading. I ask you usually to finish for homework. And then in the follow-up class, we discuss the themes. We discuss the vocabulary, of course, if we need to. We try to understand how this relates to how the story relates to us, because we're all from different cultures. These are mostly American short stories. Obviously, they're in English. So we've got a new one today. So I suggest that you open the link that I gave you in the chat window or download it. I will also share my screen, but it might be easier for you to have a copy on your computer, okay? So
Okay.
let's take a look. When I was in university, I remember the book of short, it's not really a book of short stories. It was a novel, but it was broken up into little vignettes, little, not exactly short stories, but little, kind of little stories around one character called Jesus' son. You can, does that sound familiar to you? Remember the Velvet Underground?
Are you talking about Dennis Johnson? No?
His first book, or the one that I remember many years ago, was called Jesus' Son.
Ah, yes,
Have you heard
yes.
of that?
We have read in our lesson, in our class, no?
No, not at all. It's a novel. But he took the title, I think he took the title from the Velvet Underground, because
Yes. It's a song by Velvet Underground. Yeah,
It's
same name.
a lyric. It's a lyric inside of one of the songs. I think it's in Heroin, because it's I feel just like Jesus' son. So the name of the novel was Jesus' Son. I read it a long time ago, maybe 15, more than 15 years ago. So, and I think that was kind of his big debut in the 90s. So the kind of the mid 90s. So I think what we're going to do with some of these newer stories, because I'm now picking out stories that are not classics, or they're not classics yet, there's not a lot of information on them. So I think what we're going to do is change the format of the class a little bit. Because with Delmore Schwartz, for example, now there's a very influential writer who is not really known today, the one that we read last time. So I think since there's not a lot of resources, I think what we're going to do is spend a class reading, and then in the follow-up class, not just discuss the story we're reading, but we should open it up to discuss any of the stories that we've read in the past. I say that because I think it's going to take a while to digest and to think about some of these, some of what we're reading. And as I find more resources, I'm going to keep adding it. So we're going to do the same with Dennis Johnson, I think, because he's just too new. That's what I was going to say. Same with Delmore Schwartz, the last story we read, In Dreams Come Responsibilities. I added a little bit more material to that last story as well, including a little bit of background about where the story came from and a little bit about his biography. So if you go back, you'll see links. And I did the same here. Take a look. Whoops. On the second page, I try to always give you a link where you hear someone reading the story so that you can always hear a native speaker say these words. Okay? That means you can practice along. You can just listen to it, read and listen at the same time later on if you want. I've got an interview, so that's something you could read between now and the next class over the weekend. Read the interview it'll give you some more ideas about how to approach the story. Okay? So that's the new format of the class. In the follow-up class, we'll discuss any of the stories. The main focus will be on the one we read, but I think it's going to take time to sort of figure out what we think about the previous stories because they're so new. They're contemporary writers. Okay? I'm not going to say anything more about Dennis Johnson. I think we ought to just read. I don't think it's too difficult to understand the language. So we're going to focus on reading, pronunciation, and I'll ask some comprehension questions along the way.
Mm-hmm.
Sound good?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yes.
Let's do it. As is our tradition, Carmen always begins the short story. I don't know why, but she always does.
But, John, I thought we were going to discuss the In Dreams Begin Responsibilities, because that's the last one we read.
Oh, but I thought the last class was the discussion class.
Ah, okay, then. No, because I was just, I've done some research about this author, and and I found that these short stories are quite autobiographical. You know, he was born in New York City. The place is very familiar to him. All the places he was describing, Coney Island and that sort of thing.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. Mm-hmm. The dream was his dream.
That's it. And absolutely. And he wrote the short story when he was 21. So it all makes sense now.
It does?
Well, a little bit. Because her parents were divorced and it was very hard for him because they wanted him to take sides. I mean, for him or the mother or the father. So
right.
it was a little burden for him all his life. He got divorced too. He got a lot of trouble with that. He did drugs. He had a lot of trouble drinking too. So he died when he was just 51, I think, alone in a hotel. And they took 3 days to find his corpse.
Ooh.
So he died alone, you know. So
what year did he die? Do you know? Or more or less when?
He was 51, 1966.
66.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, right. Because I was saying that in the class, because Lou Reed dedicated, what was it, the album? I can't remember now. He dedicated, I think it was the album or one of the songs on the album to him.
Mm-hmm. Anyway, was very interesting.
Oh, right. That's what it was. Yes, yeah. Well, in the beginning of the class, I played European Sun. That's what it was. So it was the song European Sun. Well, let's do it like this. I put a new article that's about his biography. Mm-hmm. So I put it in the links to the story. It's the third link. So maybe what we can do is talk about it when we discuss this story as well, and give you a little time to read some of the background. So I think it'll be better because things are going to come up. In the other stories, the classic stories, I really had a lot of resources, and I could sort of frame the story for you, but it's a little hard to do with this because I think we really have to just read it and think about it over time. Mm-hmm. So let's do it like that, because I'm pretty sure the last class was the discussion, if I'm not mistaken. I think it was. You never know. My memory.
It's okay, no matter.
May fail me. I don't know. So let's begin this one, and next Tuesday we can discuss that, both of them. We can discuss this and anything else that comes up with Delmore Schwartz. There's more I'd like to say about it as well. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
Shall we try it?
Mm-hmm.
Carmen?
Yeah.
Totally. As always, you are the inaugural reader, Carmen.
Okay.
You've been elected.
Are you going to share the screen?
I did share the screen.
Are you? Okay.
Can you see now?
Yes, I see it now. Mm-hmm.
All right. Go for it, Carmen.
Okay, then. Emergency by Dennis Johnson. I've been working in the emergency room for about 3 weeks, I guess. It was 1973, before the summer ended, with nothing to do on the overnight shift but batch the in-service support from the daytime shifts. I just started wandering around over the coronary care unit, down to the cafeteria, etc., looking for Georgie, the orderly, a pretty good friend of mine. He often stole pills from the cabinet.
Okay. Where are we? This is a kind of a different setting than the other stories, isn't it? So if you had to sum it up, what's your first impression of the story, Carmen?
It's a hospital, I think.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
So tell us what gives your first impression. The place, the time, the characters, the feeling. I know we've just read one paragraph, but give us your first impression.
I think he's doing the overnight shift, mm-hmm. and he worked in the emergency room unit. It was the summer of 1973.
Good summer.
Mm-hmm.
I remember it well.
How can you remember that summer? That was so long ago.
I was 6 months old. I remember.
Okay. And
and what do you think about the characters from what we know?
Oh, we don't know pretty much. There's someone called Georgie.
That's true.
And I don't know anything about the main character who's telling the story.
Well, seems kind of like a drug addict or a thief, one or the other or both.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Seems kind of a dubious character, doesn't he?
Mm-hmm. Because, yeah, he steals pills from the cabinet.
So we don't know.
A drug addict or something.
Or maybe he's selling them.
Mm-hmm.
So we're already put into an interesting world because it's called emergency. So that means it's probably the emergency room. People are probably stressed out. You get the idea that they stay up all night, and it's not a place where you'd really want to be, I suppose. We don't know what our narrator does. But we're already put into this late-night, stressful, confusing, horrible world of an emergency room with people who steal pills from the cabinet. Hmm.
Well, yes, I've got a question. When you talk about orderly, that's the orderly officer who works in there.
Hmm. Well, not an officer, but the people that are bringing the patients from the ambulance.
Ah, okay. The hospital worker. Okay.
Yeah, the worker. Exactly.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Thanks.
All right. So we're just going to go around the room. This is a lot of dialogue. So we're going to go around the room taking maybe half a page each or something like that. So Hyde, why don't you continue? Yeah, take the next page for us.
He was running over the tiled floor of the operating room with a mop. Are you still doing that? I said. Jesus, there are a lot of blood here, he complained. Where? The floor looked clean enough to me. What the hell was they doing?
Wait, hold on a second. We need to mute our friend here. Sorry, who is this? I can't see your name. Adil. Sorry, Adil. We need to mute you because we're hearing a lot of background noise, okay? So just follow along. Everyone will get a chance to read, but keep your microphone off for just a minute until you're ready, okay? Sorry, Hyde. Go ahead.
What the hell were they doing in here? He asked me. They were performing the surgery, George, I told him. There's so much goop inside of us, man, he said, and it all wants to get out. He leaned his mop against the cabinet.
Yeah, keep going.
What are you crying for? I didn't understand. He stood still, raised both arms slowly behind his head, and tightened his ponytail. Then he grabbed the mop and started making board random up with it, trampling and weeping and moving all around the place really fast. What am I crying for? He said. Jesus, wow. Oh boy, perfect.
Okay, so maybe we know a little bit more. So who's talking to whom here? Is that clear, Hyde? Who are we talking to here?
He's talking on the staff. He's cleaning on the floor.
He's talking to Georgie, right?
Mop. Yes, with mop.
Okay, what does Georgie look like? Can you picture him?
Georgie is the man.
That's true.
He's quite a good worker. He's working on the floor.
Do you think he's a well-educated gentleman from Oxford or no? How would you describe him? Because we got a few details, right? First of all, he tightens his ponytail. Simple worker. What about his ponytail? What's a ponytail?
He has long hair.
Yeah, he's got long hair. It's tied back.
But it travels on, so he tied up behind his head.
Okay, there's that. And his medical diagnosis, I love this, his medical diagnosis. There's so much goop inside of us that it all wants to come out. That's his medical diagnosis.
What is that goop?
I guess goop is anything that you don't know the name for, and that's liquidy.
Mm-hmm. All the things we've got inside us.
Whatever's inside of us that wants to come out. I guess he means blood and guts, but he calls it goop. Normally you think of goop if you're it's during Halloween and you're trying to carve out a pumpkin. You take out the goop. That's like the liquidy stuff inside the pumpkin with the seeds. I don't normally think of people having goop. So Georgie is not the most technical of orderlies. Let's put it that way. Okay, just so that we start to get a sense of the characters we're dealing with. By the way, we're in the emergency room. There's going to be lots of stress. People are in pain. There's probably going to be lots of bad language coming up. Just warning you now, okay? So if you don't like bad language, just be aware, okay? Because I try to cut it out of the other stories, but in this time I didn't have time. So anyway, just letting you know. Who didn't read? Sorry. So Yuki, let's take the next probably two pages. This is short. It's just dialogue. So take the next two pages, Yuki.
Okay. I was hanging out in the ER with a fat, quivering nurse, one of the family service doctors that nobody liked.
Pause. See, in English, the problem is we don't put commas unless we don't put them to pause, you know, between ideas. We put them for other purposes, for grammatical reasons. So you have to sort of put them in, which is difficult. You have to put them in yourselves. So it's that no one liked is an adjective describing the nurse, right? The one of the pharmaceutical doctors. No, sorry, describing the doctor. That nobody liked describes the doctor. So that's an interjection that nobody liked.
One of the family service doctors, family service doctors that nobody liked came in looking for Georgie to wipe up after him. Where's Georgie? This guy asked. Georgie's in OR. Nurse said, again? No, nurse said, still. Still? Doing what? Cleaning the floor. Again? No, nurse said again, still. Back in OR, George dropped his mop and bent over in posture of a child soiling into diapers. He stares down with his mouth open in terror. He said, what am I going to do about these fucking shoes, man? Whatever you stole, I said, I guess you already ate it all, right? Listen to how they squish, he said, walking around carefully on his heels. Let me check your pocket, man. He stood still a minute. I found his stash.
This is his stash of pills, by the way. The stash is something you've hidden.
I found his stash. I left him two of each, whatever they were. Shift is about half over, I told him. Good. Because I really, really, really need a drink. He said, will you please help me get this blood mopped up?
Yeah, so what do you think's going on here? What do you think's happening here? You have to understand the word stash. If you don't understand that, it might not be so clear. So this is his stash of pills. When you hide something, it's stashed, you stash it away. Okay? So is that clear? What's the transaction that's happened here, Yuki?
This man, Georgie. Georgie is used to hide a drug somewhere. Right. He's storing a drug from cabinet, and he stashed them for his purpose. Uh-huh. And nurse is doubtful. For him.
What's he doing? Does his behavior seem normal?
I think it abnormal.
Yeah. Look at that first line on the top of the page, right? Georgie dropped his mop and bent over in the posture of a child soiling its diapers. We've probably all seen children soiling their diapers. So he's sort of squatting down with a mop in the middle of the OR. OR is operating room. Operating room. OR. Right? So, he's acting a little weird. And also this line here. He's talking about his shoes. Listen how they squish, he said, walking around carefully on his heels. Why are his shoes squishing? What is squish? Do you know what squish is?
Squish?
Mm-hmm. What is squish?
Squish it sounds like you walk in the water.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Right. He's not walking in water. He's walking in goop. Mm-hmm. Goop that came from inside of us, as he calls it.
That's so sticky.
Basically, you've got a guy walking around in operating room blood. He's there to mop it up, right? But he's acting pretty weird because he's probably taken half of the pills that he stole. And the narrator, because this is, I left him two of each. So he left him just enough pills for him not to, freak out and go crazy. He left him just enough pills so he can stay in his state, in his wake, I don't know if we're going to call that awake, whatever his state of mind is. We left him two and took the rest away from him because he's already acting pretty weird. So we're in an interesting world. Where do you think this takes place? Are we in Reykjavik, Iceland? Are we in the Congo? Where do you think we are? Where's the setting? Where would you say? If you had to guess, where do you think we are?
In the U.S., no?
I don't know. We don't know from the story. I'm just saying, what's your impression? I think it's in the U.S. They're speaking English, yeah? Do you think we're out there in the country somewhere? Or do you think we're in a big city?
I think it's a rural area, no?
I don't know, yeah. We don't know.
Why is it a big city? I don't know. I have no idea.
I get the impression, personally, it seems like we're in a big city hospital.
Mm-hmm.
I get that impression.
Yeah.
I don't think it is taking place in big city. I feel something. If it were in big city, there are many people in the hospital and they are very busy. They have to be. They should be very busy, but here
they would be very busy.
Yuki said it's a night shift. It's not during the daytime. It's a night time.
Yeah, but he's got a point. If you're in New York City, the emergency room is probably pretty busy, especially at night. Right? I mean, because it's kind of a 24-hour thing. But we'll see. Yeah, maybe it's just a slow night. It happens sometimes. Maybe it's just a slow night. Okay.
Maybe so, it would be the hospital in the suburb, maybe.
Mm-hmm.
Could be. Mm. I can't remember where Jesus' son took place. I can't remember. It's been too long. But I have a feeling it's connected. I think these are kind of semi-autobiographical. Well, let's find out. Ahmed, why don't you take the next page? We're on page 6, okay?
Okay. Around 3:30 a.m., a guy with a knife in his eye came in, led by Georgia.
Georgie.
I hope you didn't do that to him, nurse said. Me? George said. No, he was like this. My wife did it, the man said. The blade was buried to the hilt in the outside corner of his left eye. It was a hunting knife, not a kind of thing. Who brought you in? Nurse said. Nobody. I just walked down. It's only 3 blocks, the man said.
You know, it's convenient when someone sticks a knife in your eye. You just go across the street. It's very convenient.
Nurse peered at him. You would better get you lying down. Okay, I am certainly ready for something like that, the man said. She peered a bit longer into his face. Is your other eye, she said, a glass eye?
So wait a second. If he has a knife stuck in his eye, and his other eye is a glass eye, how did he walk to the hospital? Just curious.
What does it mean, knife in his eye?
It means he's got a knife in his eye. Yeah. He's got a knife stuck in his eye. That's what it means. Knife stuck in his eye means there's a knife stuck in his eye. His wife stabbed him in the head. As they sometimes do. Or as they would like to. I know mine would. Here's the question. If he's got a knife stuck in one of his eyes and the other one is a glass eye, how did he walk? I'm just curious. How did he get to the hospital? Is that just me?
Well, he's blind, no?
Yeah. Well, hang on a second. Because it says, is your other eye a glass eye? Is your other eye Because it seems like it's the other eye that the knife was in. We'll find out. We'll find out. Okay, Ahmed, let's find out. Keep going.
Okay. It's plastic or something artificial like that, he said. And you can see out of this eye, she asked, meaning the wounded one. I can see, but I can't make first out of my left. My left hand, because this knife is doing something to my brain. My God, nurse said. I guess I would better get the doctor, I said.
Yeah, I guess so, right? Mm-hmm. It's always a good idea if you've got a knife stuck in your face. Okay, sorry, go ahead.
There you go, nurse agreed. They got him lying down, and Georgie says to the patient name, Terence Weber, your face is dark. I can't see what you are saying.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Shall I continue or I stop?
We'll keep going around. So, Carmen, why don't you continue? After Georgie, I said, the next page, we'll pick it up there. Can you see where we're on page 8?
What are you saying, man? I can't see. Nurse came over, and Georgie said to her, his face is dark. She leaned over the patient. How long ago did this happen, Terry? She shouted down into his face. Just a while ago. My wife did it. I was asleep. The patient said, Do you want the police? He thought about it and finally said, not unless I die.
Ooh. Has this ever happened to you?
To me? No, no way. Nurse went to the wall intercom and burst the door on duty. The family service person got a surprise for you, she said over the intercom. He took his time getting down the hall to her because he knew she hated family service, and her happy tone of voice could only mean something beyond his competence and potentially humiliating.
All right. Wait a second here. What's the surprise that the nurse has for the family service person?
For this guy, as he's got a knife stuck in his eye. It's a nice surprise.
Exactly. Wait. Okay, fine. I was going to say something, but I think the story says it enough. Let's keep going here. So, Yuki, let's pick it up on page 9.
He peeked into the trauma room and saw a situation, a crack standing next to the orderly, George, both of us on drugs, looking down at the patient with a knife sticking up out of his face. What seems to be the trouble? He said. The doctor gathered the three of us around him in the office and said, "Here's the situation. We are got to get a team here and an entire team. I want a good eye man, a great eye man, the best eye man. I want a brain surgeon, and I want a really good gas man. Get me a genius. I'm not touching that head. I'm just going to watch this one. I know my limits. We'll just get him prepared.
Prepped.
I'll just get him prepped and sit tight, orderly. Do you mean me? George said. Should I get him prepared?
Prepped. So this is a guy mopping the floor asking if he should prepare the patient, by the way.
Prepped. Should I get him prepped? Is this a hospital? The doctor asked. Is this the emergency room? Is that a patient? Are you the orderly? I dialed the hospital operator and told her to get me the eye man and the brain man and the gas man. George could be heard across the hall, washing his hands and singing Neil Young song that went, "Hello, cool girl in the sand. Is this place at your command?"
Do you know that song?
I don't know.
Oh, you can't sing it for us. That's too bad. What do you make of the situation so far? Hello?
Yes.
Oh. Would you want to be the guy with the knife in your eye in this hospital?
Now doctor scrutinized what was happened in this with
yeah.
This yeah.
Would you feel safe in this situation, Yuki? If you were the one who came in, how would you feel?
I feel something dangerous.
A little bit, right.
A little bit, yes.
Because the guy who's going to prep you from surgery is on drugs, and he's singing Neil Young songs.
Yes,
right.
Kind of crazy.
And the doctor who comes in the room isn't going to operate on you because he knows his limits. What's he do? Okay, well, that's good that he's honest. But he's a doctor. What's he going to do? It's a little bit confusing. Well, let's see what happens next. Okay, I think we're back to Ahmed, right? I lost my place. I don't know where we are. I think we're back to Ahmed for... Actually, yeah. Okay, go ahead. You're on 10.
Isn't right, not at all, not one bit, the doctor said. As long as my instructions are audible to him, it doesn't concern me. Nurse insisted spooning stuff up out of a little Dixie cup. I have got my own life and the protection of my family to think of. Well, okay. Don't chew my head off.
Don't chew my head off. Do you know that expression? To chew someone out, to chew their head off.
Oh, what's the meaning of this expression?
That's a good question.
To scold.
In other words, how is the nurse treating the doctor?
Mm-hmm.
How is the nurse treating the doctor? If she's scolding him, how is she treating him?
Mm-hmm.
Hello? Anyone?
I can suppose an opposite situation, but it really happens when nurse chew doctor's head. No?
It's the opposite of what you might expect. Is that
yes.
what you mean?
Yes.
Because no one likes this doctor, right? It was mm-hmm. a family service doctor. So he's maybe not really an emergency room doctor, so he's just telling everyone else what to do. He's not going to take part. And so the nurse is chewing off his head. She's scolding him.
I think he's a family doctor.
Exactly. Okay. He's like a...
Yeah.
He was someone sent there because it's part of his duty, I guess, through family services. Did I skip you before, Carmen? I'm sorry. Maybe I lost my place here.
No. It was Ahmed's turn. Yes.
Okay. All right. So, Ahmed, keep going. Let's you take the rest of this page, and we'll go back to Carmen.
The eye man was on vacation or something, while the hospital's operator called around to find someone else just as good. The other specialists were hurrying through the night to join us. I stood around looking at charts and chewing up more of Georgie's pills. Some of them tested the way urine smells. Some of them burned. Some of them tested like shark. Various nurses and two physicians who would be tending somebody in ICU. In what?
Sorry, say again. Physicians.
Physicians. And two physicians who would be tending somebody in ICU. We're hanging out down here with us now. Everybody had a different idea about exactly how to approach the problem. How to approach the problem of removing the knife from Terrence Weber's brain. But when Georgia came in from bribing the patient, from shaving the patient's eyebrow and disinfecting the area around the wound, and so on, he seemed to be holding the hunting knife in his left hand.
Keep going.
The talk just dropped off a cliff. Where? The doctor asked finally, did you get that? Nobody said one thing more, not for quite a long time. After a while, one of the ICU nurses said, Your shoulders is united. Georgie laid the knife on a shirt and bent down to fix the shoe, his shoe.
Oh, okay. Your shoelace is untied. Sorry, I didn't catch that. Your shoelace is untied.
Your shoelace is untied. Yeah.
Okay. So, what I was going to say here. So, what's happened so far? What's the situation up to this point? So that everything is really clear, Ahmed. So, they're in the emergency. They're in the ICU. Do you know what that is? ICU. Does anyone know what that is? We know that OR is the operating room. ICU is intensive care unit. ICU, intensive care unit. So that's a place. That's a place for serious problems in the emergency room. Okay. And what's happening so far, from the part that you read, Ahmed? Where are we? What's going on in the ICU?
What's going on is that they are in the ICU. They make a. They ask or make a discussion. The doctor make a discussion
with the nurse.
With the nurse. About Georgie. And they propose Georgie laid the knife in his. I don't know.
It's going directly into his brain. It's through his eye into his brain, right? Mm-hmm. Is the doctor going to do anything about it? Yeah, go ahead.
I think he is not going to do anything.
Exactly. He doesn't seem to know what to do. Or at least he's trying to get everyone else. So basically, they're going to prep the guy. The guy who's prepping him is singing a Neil Young song and taking lots of pills. The clerk, the narrator, is doing kind of the same, and they're just getting him ready because it seems like a little bit of a circus. Seems that way. Okay, we've got a little bit of time left, so Carmen, let's start on 11. Take the next section for us.
There were 20 more minutes left to get through. How's the guide doing, I asked. Who? Georgie said. It turned out that Terence Weber still had an excellent vision in the one good eye, an acceptable motor and reflex, despite his earlier motor complaint. His vitals are normal.
His vitals are normal.
Vitals. His vitals are normal, nurse said. There's nothing wrong with the guy. He's one of those things.
You know, just one of those things.
But I don't get it. What happened? What happened to the knife that was stuck in the eye?
It's still there, but he's able to see.
Through the knife and his eyes.
Yeah.
Okay. After a while, you forget summer. You don't remember what the morning is. I've worked two doubles with 8 hours off in between, which I'd spent sleeping on a gurney in the nurse's station. George's pills were making me feel like a giant helium-filled balloon.
Helium-filled balloon.
Helium-filled balloon. But I was wide awake. Georgie and I went out to the lot to his orange pickup.
What's a pickup?
A car?
It's a truck, a little truck.
Okay, a truck. Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh. And so let me get this straight, Carmen. The clerk and the orderly are carrying around balloons in the hospital. Is that right?
Mm-hmm.
Is that right? They're carrying around balloons?
The what, sorry?
The orderly and the clerk, the orderly mm-hmm. Georgie and
oh,
the clerk,
yes, yes.
They're mm-hmm. They're carrying around balloons in the hospital and acting like children. Is that right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I don't know.
No. What's this balloon?
No. I mean, he's on drugs because he has swallowed all George's pills, and now he feels like a giant helium-filled balloon. That's different.
Yeah, what does that feel like, I wonder? What does it feel like to be a giant helium-filled balloon? I don't know exactly.
It's like you're going to explode or something. I don't know.
Maybe. Maybe.
You're high on something, so...
Oh, that's it. He's getting higher and higher, like a balloon. I got it, because helium is lighter than air. Oh, that's mm-hmm. a good one. Right. So he feels like he's floating around at the top of the ceiling. Mm-hmm. This is a good hospital to go to if you get a knife stuck in your head. I'd want everyone on drugs around me. But as he points out, does he sleep? Does he ever sleep?
No. No.
He worked double shift.
Mm-hmm.
And he sleeps with gurney. Good vocabulary. What's a gurney? Does anyone know? Gurney?
This is where the nurses sleep when they are off duty, no?
It's not where the nurses sleep, no.
I know.
The gurney is the thing that takes you from the ambulance to the operating table. That's the gurney.
Oh, like the stretcher?
Like a stretcher, exactly.
Oh, okay.
The mm-hmm. stretcher is one you carry, and the gurney is on wheels.
So
he's sleeping where they put sick people. Like that's what he's doing. So that's his life. You can kind of figure out why he's on drugs, perhaps.
Okay.
All right. I'm just going to... let me just see how much... I'm going to try to find a good... I'm going to just do this last section. We're going to have to stop here. Let me just read this last section after the gurney. We lay down on a stretch of dusty plywood in the back of the truck with the daylight knocking against our eyelids and the fragrance of alfalfa thickening our tongues. I want to go to church, Georgie said. Let's go to the county fair. I would like to worship. I would. They have these injured hawks and eagles there from the Humane Society, I said. I need a quiet chapel right now. That's Georgie speaking. Georgie and I had a terrific time driving around. For a while, the day was clear and peaceful. It was one of those moments you stay in. To hell with all the troubles of before and after. The sky is blue, and the dead are coming back. Later in the afternoon, with sad resignation, the county fair bares its breasts. A champion of the LSD, a very famous of the Love Generation, is being interviewed amid a TV crew off to the left of the poultry cages. His eyeballs look like he bought them in a joke shop. I can see that, can't you? It doesn't occur to me, as I pity this extraterrestrial, that my life I've taken as much acid as he has. Okay, we're gonna have to stop there. We're a bit out of time. The story is a lot of dialogue, as you can see. So I think what we can do. Let me get my screen share off. Hold on a second here. There we go. So what I'm going to ask you to do is, it's pretty easy, I think, to understand the language here, because it's mostly people talking. So I'll ask you to read the rest of the story. Take a look at some of the links that I have given you as well, because maybe I can suggest. Let me just take a look. You can read and listen, because I have, I have the story being read by Tobias Wolf, a writer. You've also got an interview there. So take a look at that, and we'll come back to this next Tuesday. We can talk more about the Delmore Schwartz story as well. So read the story or read and listen to the MP3 that I posted, and we're going to talk about both stories in the next class. Are there any questions about what's going on before we go? How clear is it? Thank you. Are there any questions about the story before we go?
No.
We're okay? Mm-hmm. Just one question for all of you. How would you describe, I don't know if this is going to be clear, how would you describe the tone of the story so far? How would you describe the tone, kind of the attitude of the narrator or the feeling of the story?
I think the tone is a little more. I think it is not happily dismal.
A little bit dismal, okay.
A little terrible.
Is it completely dismal and terrible? Completely?
Not completely. Some kind of humor is working on in this story.
Exactly. It's kind of humorous at the same time. What do you think, Carmen? What would you say?
About the tone of the...
Yeah.
The narrator, you think?
The narrator or just the impression of the story in general. So Yuki's saying it's dismal, but there's some kind of humor there as well.
Or it's real. So kind it's of very... language you're going to find in the hospital night shift.
And these are not idealistic characters. They all seem very real and sort of gritty. Okay. The word I was going to use is there seems to be a lot of irony going on.
Irony. Yes, humor coexists with severe reality. Very realistic situation, but
maybe not severe. Let's use the word harsh.
Harsh reality.
Yeah.
Harsh reality coexists with irony, with funny moment. Funny.
There's something funny about a guy who gets a knife stuck in his eye.
Yes.
They get him on the operating table, and the nurse says, "Is your other eye fake?" It's just something funny. I mean, of all the eyes he could have been stabbed in, why didn't she stab him in the artificial eye, right? I guess she was trying to make a point. I don't know. And where are we? Now we know a little bit more about the story. So are we in a big city?
Yes.
We are?
We don't know. How do you know?
We do know. Yuki was right. Yuki was absolutely right, because remember, it says, let's go to the county fair.
Yes.
Ah, okay. Right?
So the county fair has got to be in a county, which means outside the city. I forgot exactly where the line was. But it seems like they are in a kind of rural place because it's at county fair, and I lost my place. I can't figure out where it is. I don't know where it is. But the last thing we read is that they're driving around, and they're going to a county fair, and there's animals there, and so it kind of gets the sense that it might be a little bit rural. Mm. Okay, so just some details to keep in mind. All right, the next class is 10 o'clock GMT, the next short story class, on Tuesday, next Tuesday. So read the story, or read and listen, going to that link that I posted for you inside of the story on page 2. Read the interview, perhaps, or some background. We'll talk about the story. And look at the links as well for Delmore Schwartz, because if we have time, maybe we can discuss both of them as well. If you had some more time to think about the story and mold it over, digest it a little bit, okay?
Okay.
All right. I'm going to stop the class now. I'll be back in just a minute for the last of our How to Talk About Success classes in the business class, in the getting results, okay? So I'll be back in just a minute if you're sticking around. If not, I'll see you bright and early tomorrow at 10 GMT if I don't see you today. And next short story class, next Tuesday and Thursday. Don't forget. Okay. Bye for now. See you soon.
Thank you. Have a nice day all. Bye-bye.
Bye for now. Thank you.